Hi. By now, I hope you've ranked the 24 character strengths for your students, completed the VIA, and compared the two. Over the past 5 years, I've done this activity with at least 1,000 teachers and principals. We always have a good time doing it. Here's an example from a recent group. They, like many groups before them, ranked grit as the most important strength for kids. But when we averaged their VIA scores, we found that for a group of adults, it was the 9th highest strength. Love tops their VIA results, but they ranked it 9th for kids. And how about self-control? The adults ranked self-control as number 4 for students, but the VIA showed it was the lowest collective score for that group, 24 out of 24. This always brings plenty of laughs to the group. We're often asking kids to do things that we don't enjoy or choose to do ourselves. This doesn't mean we don't ask. It just means we should ask with empathy. The set of 24 strengths comes from the research of Dr. Martin Seligman at the University of Pennsylvania and the late Dr. Chris Peterson at the University of Michigan. They found that these 24 character strengths, in their different combinations, help people flourish. And here's an exciting fact. These 24 strengths lead to flourishing across gender, class, race, culture, geography, basically across all the things that divide us. We have these character strengths in common. Okay, so there are 24 character strengths. We all have these 24 strengths in different combinations that are unique to us and that are important for us to flourish as individuals. That's why I hope you took the VIA. Of the 24, this course focuses on the strengths that we believe have the greatest impact at school and are particularly predictive of positive life outcomes beyond. It's important to recognize that many of our character strengths can change over time. You may act gritty in one circumstance, but not another. Or you may become more socially intelligent as you observe your community over time. That's why Dr. Peterson and Dr. Seligman use the term character strength and not character trait. Trait too often makes us think about things like the color of your eyes or your height, something fixed. A strength, though, or a character skill, is something you can work on and hone. Strengths or skills, not traits, please. Let's talk character strength and PERMA with Dr. Marty Seligman. What's a character strength?
Well, first question is, what's character? So character, in Chris Peterson and my hands, was the set of strengths that contributed to well-being that every parent wanted for every child, that every religion, every politics across time has agreed on. So those are the strengths of character.
How did you land on the 24? That are in character strengths?
Well, it took about 3 years looking at 100 or so strengths and whittling it down to 24 that were universal, that every parent wanted, that when, if you displayed them, it didn't diminish me. So we had 11 criteria of character strengths, and it had to fulfill all 11, and we whittled it down to 24 that way.
In your most recent book, you introduced the concept of PERMA. Can you define PERMA,
yeah,
and what does it equate to?
Well, positive psychology is in general about what free people not suffering choose to do. And I think there are 5 elements that we choose under those conditions. And the acronym is PERMA. P is positive emotion, where happiness is a good shorthand. E is engagement, being one with the music. R is good relationships. M is meaning and purpose, and A is accomplishment. So those are the 5 things that I believe human beings, when they're not suffering, choose. What's north of indifference.
So is PERMA equal to, does PERMA equal flourishing?
Yes, so for me, having PERMA equals flourishing.
What do you see as the connection between character strengths and PERMA?
I don't think we really know. I think of character strengths as the backbone of PERMA. So I think when you know your character strengths and when you act on them, that gives you more positive emotion, it gives you more engagements, gives you better relationships, gives you more meaning, and it gives you accomplishment. So for me, character strengths are something like physical health, that the more of it you have, the more it feeds into PERMA. So that's my guess about the role of character strengths in PERMA. And it makes character strengths primary to well-being.
Can character strengths be taught?
I think some can and some can't. So I spent a lot of my life teaching optimism, and it's clear you can increase that. I've been very interested, can you increase integrity or honesty or authenticity? And I really don't know if you can. Can you increase humor? Yeah, probably. Can you increase zest? Well, I don't know. So I think if we take all the character strengths that interest us in school, some are very changeable. Optimism being a great example.
What is optimism, and why is it? Why are the ripples so tremendous?
Well, I think human beings are creatures of the future, and we're not prisoners of the past. So the question is, how do we project ourselves into the future? And I think the answer is, to the extent we project into the future with hope, the belief that more good things will occur, that you can do something about them, and they will pervade your life, and fewer bad things will occur. You can change bad things, and when bad things happen to you, they're local. That's to view your future with hope. And the mechanism of optimism, when we view our future with hope and optimism, is we try harder. Conversely, the mechanism of pessimism is fatalism, giving up, learned helplessness. So optimism is the lever by which we project ourselves into a positive future.
And the ripples of optimism result from that belief?
Well, the ripples of optimism, there are several. First, you get less depressed when bad events occur. You're more resilient. Secondly, your physical health is better. Third, people like you better. And fourth, because you try harder, you achieve more. So the ripples of optimism are not just feeling good, it's doing better in the world.
How should schools think about PERMA?
Schools have two aims. One is to produce learning, that's the traditional aim, but the other aim is to build well-being, and that means increasing PERMA. Learning is in some ways subsumed by the A in PERMA, but very importantly, the P, the positive emotion, the engagement, how good your relationships are with the teacher, and the meaning all amplify the A. And the A also amplifies how happy you are, how good your relationships are, how much meaning you have. So I see them as causally bidirectional. If you increase PERMA, you increase how much kids learn in school. If you increase how much they learn, you increase PERMA.
If you could speak to every teacher about how you could go about improving PERMA in your classroom, what would be on your list?
So let's say you decide that your goal as a teacher is to increase PERMA in your students, and you're going to measure it. So that means at time when you sit down, and there are plenty of ways of measuring PERMA in kids in school, and you measure it. And then you find ways over the next week that are local to your classroom that increase PERMA, and then you measure it again next week. It's called an invisible hand argument, and its structure is simply, once you decide you value it and you're going to measure it, you will think of all the ways of doing it. So this puts creativity back in the hands of the teachers.